okay with that. Right, agenda item 9 is a report commissioning community services, managing the market and reducing reliance on residential and nursing care services. I've got Jackie Evans from the DAS. Hello, Jackie.
Hello.
Who's going to present this, and then I'll just say something about it.
Okay, thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. Obviously, you've had the paper, so I'm not going to go through that line by line, but I think the key message from adults' perspective is that over the past 18 months, 2 years, we've worked very hard, I think, to really shape the market in rural. There was absolutely no reliance on residential nursing care, and there was a very underdeveloped market, community market, for people to have alternative options for them. And therefore, we were not necessarily to the right outcomes for people either. So what the paper's done there is to try and describe to you the work that's been taken on over the past several months. In essence, what we have done is to really invest in improving our contracted services around domiciliary care and re-ablement. We've been able to re-tender those services, and we now have a really robust, responsive response for people from both domiciliary and re-ablement, where we have services in place same day, 7 days a week, and those services are picking up referrals between 7 in the morning and 11 at night. So that's really supporting discharge from hospitals, but actually making sure that we can keep people in their own homes without them having to go into short-stay placements. With regards to intermediate care, we have invested in intermediate care services, again, so that we can avoid people having to go into hospital where that's not necessary, and then be able to support people back into their own home. We have, and there's about £6.5 million invested in those services, with the intention to invest further for 15-16 across the health and social care economy. We have also commissioned mobile night services, which were not available 12 months ago in rural. And we know that for many people, not just needing domiciliary support during the day, people need overnight support as well. So whilst we don't have an overnight sitting service as such, we do have a mobile night round that will go in and support people with whatever their needs are during the overnight period. Extra care housing is something that we are working towards. We have capital approved with the development this year to bring on 100 units of extra care housing by April 16, and a further capital bid that has just been approved, which will invest in a further 100 units again around the world for April 17. And that will be a key part of the strategy to look at appropriate alternatives to residential and nursing care. So we're really positive about those developments, and our aspiration is to have appropriate extra care facilities in each of the neighbourhood areas within Wirral. And all of those schemes are dementia friendly, and so will cater for people a range of need. So broadly speaking, those are the sort of areas that we've really invested in terms of having alternative community services. We have also invested in our contract and quality assurance team, so that we are keeping an eye on quality in the residential nursing sector. Our key aims on all of this around early intervention and prevention, re-ablement and getting the right outcomes for people. So significant investment. What we have seen over the past 12 months is as a consequence of that investment is that our residential nursing permanent placements have reduced by 10% in the last 12 months, and we absolutely expect that to continue as those community services are further invested in and further made available to people. We have seen a 36% growth in the re-ablement activity in the past year as well. So we can see that our commissions are working, they're giving good timely responses to people and ultimately keeping people home and independent and improving outcomes. Next steps in terms of further investment, we've clearly got an integration agenda, health and social care teams coming together. Those neighbourhood teams will absolutely be supporting people to ensure they make the right choices, they're a bit aware of the range of options, and we're working very hard with our health colleagues and our independent sector providers to make sure that our responses are timely so that people are not inappropriately placed in residential nursing care or inadvertently ending up with a hospital admission, that we basically get a four-hour response with whatever services are available. We do have further meetings scheduled in the next few weeks, and we do intend to try and seek approval from the Joint Commissioning Group through the Better Care Fund investment and the system resilience monies to actually then invest in multidisciplinary teams that will actually wrap around those that range of intermediate care services and really strengthen the opportunities for GPs to refer directly to those services and have an NDT response. But at the moment, what we do know is that people end up in A&E and being admitted or end up in a residential nursing placement because there hasn't been a rapid response with that GP. So that's where the next focus is, and we're hoping to get those multidisciplinary teams invested in and running by April.
And that leads me very nicely to say that the purpose of this report was, as we take another report in advance of starting a piece of panel work, to give us a position statement. Your last sentence there leads us into the next piece of panel work which we'll be undertaking, which is to avoid avoidable hospital admissions and to look at the way the different organisations are able to come together and effectively prevent people having to go into hospital in the first place and get them out in a timely way. I'll come to that later on when we talk about the work programme. We'll take any questions now to Jackie. Yes, Chris.
Thanks, Jackie. Yeah, that's really useful and interesting. Congratulations on obviously all the hard work that you've been doing. It seems to me that the discussion we're having about the crisis that we've got ongoing at the moment is part of the solution is implicit in what you're talking about. It seems to me that it's the NHS in Wales have been taking this move, and that's why, quite wrongly, some remarks have been made about Russia and NHS. My understanding is because they are looking into long-term planning to merge care with what's going on in hospitals. Really, really interested to hear about your extra care housing initiative. I just wondered if you could talk a little bit more about how that is really making a difference.
Yeah, thank you for that. So we have two capital bits of proof. The first one is to develop schemes around rural. So we are looking at 100 units. So they will start to develop in the pensive type areas. We have already got some in Wallasey. But we are, for the second round of capital, we are now looking at the areas in rural where we do not have extra care facilities. So we, as I say, we want to work towards every neighbourhood area in the next few years actually having a really high quality extra care provision as alternatives for people. We have ensured that the specs with the providers are high quality, they are dementia friendly, and they are a mixed model of care. So whilst predominantly it's for older people, these facilities will also offer support to people with disability, mental health needs and so on.
We'll be lobbying in Birkenhead for one. We haven't got one yet.
Thank you, Jackie. Thank you, Chair. Speedy response, and being able to move quickly, I want to say how valuable it is if you can get reable to whatever place. Our own family in another part of England, we've recently seen our dimension and the ability to say help as something happened quickly is just marvelous and what's needed to keep. Just interested really around some of the other things that happen that help to support people in their own homes, and I think about some of the day services or the places like Santos, for instance, where folk can go. This dementia care, effectively, isn't it, which makes things well for the carers, helps everybody's well-being. Is that included in this? Can we expect to see investment in that kind of facility as well?
Okay, so I'll answer that as best I can. I'm conscious we're still in a formal contract tender process, so I'll be delicate. Day services has been part of the review of the External Day Services Commission, and to make sure that we do have a range of day services available for people with different needs, older people, people with dementias, mental health needs. So I can't go into too much detail on the Sandhills in particular, but we absolutely are committed to continue to ensure that we have day services for a range of needs in rural and that those are accessible and available for people. So So we are investing in day services. That's still a part of that carer strategy and the wider service.
Could I just make one comment? I remember possibly two last years ago the conversation with the director, who at that stage was talking about this as a plan for the future. And it's good to see that it's beginning to take root. It seems to be the right way forward. We should all be supportive as a principle, getting people away from being institutionalised in the university.
Quick question if I may. According to this report, there were about 1,600 people went into permanent nursing or residential care. I'm not sure whether is that just what we as adult social services agreed to fund, not necessarily the full total for Wirral. But nevertheless, if you've got all the things we've heard about extra care housing, the mobile night service, perhaps improvements in district nursing and community nursing, would you like to sort of have a stab at what that number could be reduced to?
Okay, thank you for that, putting me on the spot. I think when you look at our ACRA benchmarking, we're about middle in terms of the 23 benchmarking authorities in terms of our placements into residential nursing care. We've seen a 10% reduction in the last 12 months. I would like to say we're going to bring it down at least another 10% in the next 12 months. We do need to get that range. We know that we've made good alternative provision, but we know that the MDT responses, there's still a way we can go. So I think another 10% would be realistic.
But longer term, we could go further than that?
I would like to think so. If we get a 7-day response and we get the investment in therapists, district nurses, community nurses, not just in social care, for that time before our response, and GPs can really start to access directly those supports, then I would like to think we can hit more than that.
Also been £2 million identified to be invested in the leisure.
also how we wanted to introduce some structural changes. Both of you have been delayed, hence the slippage that we've got in relation to our main target. But we aim, obviously, to want to recoup that as quickly as we can. I won't go through any more detail, Chair, because I'm interested in questions for the day.
Questions?
Yes,
Chair.
Yes,
Chair. I was looking at where to be to, you raise it where, and the last point on that page, the cost of sickness in the service was very high, equating to 12.9 days per annum. It's now just below the real council average, forecast average of 16.61. Does that mean it's reduced in the last year? And do you know how that's been achieved? Has there been any kind of disciplinary action taken over?
Well, that's actually sick, maybe that's why it's been
down,
because
you can't measure.
It's
a combination of reasons, but probably
Damien
can give you the
detail. Yeah, when we did the analysis, we had just over 33% of our sickness was tied up in 10 people, which was fairly significant. Now, we never doubt that people are sick. What we doubt is they're being worked on to complete their contract with us. So, for people who were on long-term sickness, which meant that they were particularly poor. So some of those issues have now come out the other end, and we're now working within the policies and procedures of the council to work the sickness figures down in terms of how we operate. But that's to say that the council does have a recognised policy and procedure which we're working within.
Does that mean, therefore, that there's been disciplinary action taken against people with what you perceive to be, or what was, what can be described as unacceptable sick, and also the other side of that is the appropriate levels of support for people who haven't got a high sick.
We monitor on a monthly basis, and the last monitoring figures that I've been through of the 22 cases that were in front of me. I was comfortable that action would be taken as appropriate in each of those cases. So we are doing is managing it through the policies and procedures of the council. I'm comfortable that's happening. And those people that are in the system and requiring support from the council are being supported as appropriate, either through the Employment Advice Programme or through the Occupational Health Programme. So I'm comfortable that's happening as well. There are particular cases that we've got that staff are being seen through a consultant, through a hospital consultant. So, where it's been appropriate, we've supported that with the occupational health programme, but it's not always been necessary because we know that they're in a procedure with the hospital.
Thanks.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for that. Why this occur specifically, and what we're doing to kind of amend that?
Two primary reasons. The first one was that we were looking at how we could deliver the service through alternative delivery arrangements, which is called a non-profit delivery organisation, which many of the councils use this way of delivering services. And that wasn't about putting the service out into a private sector arrangement or anything like that, but it was how the service could be structured, which would give it relief in relation to rate relief and also VAT. Particular mechanism that many authorities use. When the council know that we were looking at doing that, as part of the future council work, they felt that rather than just looking at leisure, it would be a good idea to look at the opportunity across the whole of the council. And that's why that has been deferred. So that's obviously had an impact in terms of our ability to make those savings. And we're still looking at that as part of whether there's alternative models that we could consider for other services. The second one was in relation to delays in structural change. So we did phase one, which we referenced in the report, and phase two was looking at flexible ways of working. And again, that was then deferred to be included as part of the further review of part of future council. And we're now just in our consultation phase, so we've delayed in relation to that. So what we do know is that we've got some ground to make up in terms
Wendy, and then Chris.
Thank you, Tim. Claire, the workstream three, pricing and programming, I was wondering about usage, whether that's grew significantly one way or another as you brought in the new pricing structures and the impact that's had on income.
It's just been a bit too early to have a full appraisal of that situation. We've only introduced them in January, so we're just working through those figures. Now, we always have an increase in usage in January anyway, because it's the New Year resolution boom. So we do always get a big increase in January as part of our figures. But the new guinea gap proposal looks really, really exciting. In terms of what we've done in terms of changing the old drill and all that kind of thing. I'm happy to show people around, or some people signed up if they want to come have a look at Guinea Gap, because it's made a huge difference, and we're expecting some additional income through that resource. It looks absolutely spectacular. So undoubtedly the people will use it because of the the demographics on it. So we're excited about that opportunity and what that will bring in terms of additional income, in terms of reducing our deficit.
Chris? Yeah, it's Clarence, the workshop for golf. As the daughter of a very keen golfer, I'd just like to have a bit more information about you were looking to go to a full procurement exercise with Cheshire West, and then could you tell us more about the disappointing negative response that you had to the exercise, and what was actually gives a bit more information?
Okay, so what we started with last March was a soft market testing exercise, just to see whether there was any interest out there. And we got a really good response. So we took a report to Cabinet in July to seek approval to go to a full procurement process, which we did, the Cheshire West. We had a relatively tight turnaround, because what we wanted to do was make sure that we could go through the procurement process and have the new provider in place ready to start the new season. And we had a really limited response, and we're not happy with the... we set a particular benchmark in relation to what we were expecting the new providers to achieve, but we were not confident in terms of what we were receiving. So we felt that rather than go through something we were not confident with, and we received advice from our procurement colleagues, we decided to review the whole situation again.
Okay, thanks. The point being that, you know, people on Blue are very, very proud of having access to golf links, and of course it's only simple for so everybody can take part. So we really want to make sure we get the help. Thank you. Carefully at working to engage them in positive activities.
The youth service has an outreach team, and historically has had an outreach team for a number of years, that operates in and around our communities through four contact buses that have staff, team leader staff and operations staff that can be deployed to respond to not only build relationships in communities, but to respond to instances of youth nuisance and issues. The report takes you through and shows you how the provision is focused on constituency and targeted support at individuals, and it takes you through a range of interventions and mechanisms that are used when we have particular instances of hotspots across our communities where there is youth nuisance. The report culminates in a case study that shows how some of those mechanisms have been used to reduce a particular instance of youth causing annoyance and issues with youth nuisance in the Woodchurch area. And it has been successfully seen a reduction in the instances of youth nuisance, and it also can demonstrate a greater involvement in projects and programmes that are appropriate for young people who are demonstrating not only risk-taking behaviour, but often behaviours that can cause themselves harm in now and in the future. So drug, alcohol abuse, those kinds of things that have long-term effects and leave some of our young people vulnerable to much wider instances of crime and criminal activity and instances of child sexual exploitation and those kinds of issues that we're dealing with as very relevant topics across our borough.
I know there's a consultation going on at the moment about, I think, if I get it understanding correctly, merging the community team with the antisocial team. Does that really, can you just give perhaps a little detail on that? When I look at the multi-agency approach, and there are eight different agencies listed there, I think four of them are council agencies. In effect, would we reduce, in a future report, would we see less council agencies because they've been effectively merged?
Not particularly, no. It's to bring the teams together to work more closely with our multi-agency safeguarding response at front door. It's to work in where there are difficulties across wider neighbourhoods. At the moment, the antisocial behaviour team, that is a team that works across both adults and children, sits with the youth offending team. So it's to bring it into an area of the council's compliance so that it can work more closely with wider groups of agencies as just keeping to do with children and young people.
Can I just briefly add that I think this report highlights a large number of partnership groups that take place. And one of the issues moving forward, and that Mark Campbell, who leads the Community Cohesion Group in Resilience, is reviewing whether we need quite so many groups. So it will be how we move forward, perhaps similar numbers of organisations, but not sitting round meetings week in, week out, streamlining the number of meetings.
Thanks very much, Deborah, for that. And it's interesting to read about the youth and antisocial behaviour. The reason I asked for this report, I think, in the first instance, was because I found out that this committee had the responsibility for scrutinising the antisocial behaviour team. Now, I'm pleased to see this looking at the youth aspect, but we know very well that's not the only aspect of antisocial behaviour that causes our residents' real problems. And who is in charge of the antisocial behaviour team now? Which of the directors is in charge of the antisocial behaviour team? Who's that? Cool.
Yeah,
currently, the antisocial behaviour team, as Deborah says, sits within Children's Services. So I'm responsible as a statutory
director.
Yes, so a 94-year-old knocking on a neighbour's door, calling the law, the plan is, and it's Howard Cooper, the former director, that pulled it into children's services, saying, I'm not having my children being given penalties or as those by some other part of the organisation. So hence that way, well, that's why it came in. After a lot of debate over a number of years, to and fro, where it should sit, and currently, Mark Campbell is he's out of consultation with the review that the antisocial behaviour team should move to be part of the community safety.
And when is that review likely to produce a report?
If the review will conclude in March,
could we get the result of that review reported here? Because I don't feel at the moment we could adequately say that we're keeping a weather eye on antisocial behaviour. I'm joining the whole plethora of people who are also doing that.
Absolutely. And can I just add that there in terms of the fact that it has sat with children's services, which has strengthened the relationship and the compliance and regulatory aspects that we would want to see in place when working with some of our vulnerable youngsters. We'll make sure that they continue.
We get the results of the report from the review brought to this committee so that we look at the big picture.
Yeah.
And thank you for this. Anybody else want to ask questions of Deborah on this report? Yes.
That I'm running an antisocial behaviour event on Friday in Malta Youth Club. I'm glad to hear that there is lots of departments that people I can go to for support. So thanks for that report. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Deborah. And now the next report is Child and Family Strategy Center.
Chair, I'm going to introduce you briefly, but my colleague, Heather, manager within Public Health, is here to assist with any responding to any questions that you have. Becky's got a key role in facilitating the child poverty working group and the implementation of the strategy. So this report provides a progress and an update on delivering the strategy. It sets out on the first page the focus of the working group, and on 2.2 it highlights the key aspects of the physical city region, child poverty and life chances strategy, and our local strategy and will, in common with the other Merseyside authorities, aligns with those key priorities. Lower down that page it sets out some of the work that's been overseen by the group, so overseeing improvements in school readiness amongst youngsters, training in the development of credit unions in LISO, and there's been an update and review of the JSNA, the Joint Strategic Needs Assessment, in respect of child poverty. So that's available for everyone and can underpin development of policy and strategy in all aspects of to try and mitigate the impact of child poverty. 2.3 highlights a really exciting piece of work that's been overseen by the working group during the last year. And this has been the development of two community hubs, which are two primary schools, Fender Primary School and Mother Spirit Primary School, each awarded £50,000. And they have done some quite phenomenal work that, if you've not read, I urge you to read in Appendix 2, which is directly impacting on the outcomes for children and families. Becky is very close to both of those projects and very happy to answer questions about that. But there's a lot of learning that's really important that we look at to roll out across Wales to other schools. And what we are finding is that through intervention with children and families, 52 weeks of the year, we can see that children and families' needs have been met much earlier, and it's starting to reduce the amount of vulnerability and needs we're experiencing in areas where children need more statutory and formal intervention through child protection plans or community protection plans. Really exciting. The second aspect of the plan, 2.4, highlights the work of the Birkenhead Foundation Youth Trust, which is the practical implementation of Frankfield's report, the Foundation Years Preventing More Children and again, this report highlights some of the activity that's been taking place, led by Zoe Mumby, who's the project lead. And
filing under 2.5 in terms of further developments, the Birkenhead Constituency Committee are developing a proposal for another primary school to become a community hall. Really exciting stuff, lots that we can learn from. And we really need the next step of working with the civil vet and how we then can roll out some of these quite exciting and innovative projects. Happy to answer them.
Tony, Walter, Chris, and Janet. Tony, go down the line, just straight down the line, and then back down this.
Just a question of clarification, really. Reading the chart on the pilot projects in the Italian committee report, and obviously the is the report you've just given there, actually states that Little has levels as low as 1% of child poverty in some areas and as high as 70% in other areas. A long standing issue of deprivation and disadvantage preventing families from escaping poverty. And the area I want to really ask you about and get more information on is regarding, it actually states in there that local aid suggests that the financial climate and changes to benefit systems have combined impact on children and families in poverty. So which agencies are feeding this back? And it's a question I think we asked at previous meetings about the cumulative impact of government policy, particularly on benefits, adding to the problem of child poverty.
It's a reasonable question to ask. Is there a cumulative effect of one set of things that's increasing child poverty? Otherwise, if we're not going to move off policy, we're never going to solve the problem. I think it's a reasonable question, actually. I may not like it, but I think it is a reasonable question.
I'm not sure I've got a very evidence-based answer to it. I know that some of the social work team offices in some of our more disadvantaged areas are experiencing high numbers of referrals, and some of them are linked to families experiencing financial hardship. And I think people are saying there appears to be an increase in some of the disadvantage that people are experiencing. Some of the crises that families are walking through. And this is exacerbated some of the relationship issues, for example, where there were kind of challenges around perhaps a teenager in the household, when there's that further adversity around the finances, that is just making things that little bit more stretched and more fraught. I haven't got a more detailed response.
Thank you, Chair. I'm always surprised when we get Ofsted reports of reception classes for children going into our primary school, and that there are a significant number of children with failure to recognise primary colours and simple 1, 2, 3 counting and other things, you know, real poor child development. It surprises me though, because I would have thought with universal nursery provision that we would have sorted that, we would have got to grips with it. But is this because some parents don't take advantage of the services we're offering? And I just finish off by saying, one of the great credits to our primary schools is when I read these reports, is how often the school manages to bring those children up to a required standard, so it's better in their cap. But nevertheless, I'm surprised that there's a significant number of children ill-prepared to start at primary school.
Chair, with your permission, I think this is a question that Deborah Gornet might be able to kind of respond to, with a particular focus on children being ready for school and leading the initiatives in the environment.
It is a key objective for us in terms of having an outcomes framework for school readiness that doesn't just look with a focus just on the education and child development, but opens that much more wider to focus on health issues, the children and health child programme, the work that we do with parents in terms of improving parenting capacity and parents' wellbeing. and having parents ready to work, because we know where parents are more fully engaged that children do better. We don't know why, there is just a very clear correlation between those two sets of indicators for us. So it is a real focus for us in the borough at the moment. I think that in terms of the take-up of the 3 and 4 year old offer, we have quite good take-up in Wirral against national and regional parameters. We're up in the high 80s of children taking up that offer and looking to seek out those children that aren't. And again, we are progressing well with the delivery of the 2 year old offer that is for more disadvantaged youngsters. And the government's recognised that the earlier we get them into provision, good provision, then we can start to address some of those problems. So it really is a shared agenda across all our delivery agencies that works on early childhood services. This year, we've seen the gap narrow between those children who achieve a good level of development at the end of reception, which is the clear area that we measure, from 47% to 63%. So we're seeing that reduce. However, there is still a significant gap and concern for us for our children who are in the looked after system, where there is a much wider gap. So it's whatever has happened for those children in those very early childhood experiences that we know we've not managed for them to catch up before they go into school. They go on to catch up and do particularly well, but that drops off again at the end of their formal education period. So 15, 16, we start to see a dip again. So we're keeping a careful eye on why that is. But whatever it is we're doing at the moment is not enough to narrow that gap for our most disadvantaged youngsters, and will be a focus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chris, and then
Julia and Becky, congratulations. This seems like an outstanding scheme. I've had a good read of the report today, and I think it's really exciting. What struck me particularly about the Lisa and Woodchurch examples, and I know Fender very well, I've Fender School and I've Fender Youth Club, know the area, is there seems to be a real effort to make sure that this work bubbles up from the community. It's not done in a patronising way, and there's a real ownership, and I think this is the key. In deprived communities, which are quite often, you know, stereotyped things are said about these communities, if you actually go into these communities and meet the people, they're just struggling with a whole range of issues. Not having enough money is one of those issues, which if you've never had enough money, if you've never been in that position, you can never understand, I guess. I think one of the keys is the school ambassadors element of your project. Mm-hmm. I think this is absolutely key. Peer learning, children learn more off sort of older young